Welcome to the Totally Awesome Fishing Show. We're in the favourite spot of all anglers, a fishing tackle shop, but this is no ordinary fishing tackle shop. This is Mal Story's Fishing Tackle Shop. It's Angling Centre here in Kidderminster. And we're up here to try and learn about fishing with meat. Now you're at lunch with me, you've got all the other types of bait, but I'm going down the bait counter to speak to Clive. He's going to tell me exactly the history of proper meat fishing. Hi there, Clive.
Ah, morning, buddy. How are
yeah,
you?
Yeah, yeah, good right. to be back. Good you're to be right. back. I'm in the right place, I know that. Yeah. Now, I see you're all organised here for some of this this lunch and meat, but you're going to tell us something about the history of lunch and meat fishing up here in this area.
Yeah. Okay, well, it was basically with the meat. It started off on the rivers years ago, as you know, for the barbel and stuff like that. Big thing in Stairport, where I come from, it was for the barbel and that, but of course, not so many barbel there these days. More upriver now. And it's used more the meat now with the weather conditions as they are at the moment, river being very low and clear. Brilliant for loafer float, just trundling the meat through, running it through. Fantastic.
So more so than, let's say, low water conditions, hemp and caster, maggots. So the meat's actually good this time of year for river.
Absolute brilliant, yeah. It's account for a lot of big weights with pleasure fishermen, And even the match angler on the right pegs, of course. When you're on those deeper pegs, you would be looking more to the hemp and the casters and
sure, that's feeder fishing, though. Yeah,
feeder fishing like that. Yeah, that'd be it. But of course, the meat. We go to the meat now. Is that basically the pools with the carp, the commercialised fisheries now, Morelands. It basically started off there some years ago. And of course the meat, it became so popular, the old fishermen like Billy Drews and all them, they were fishing meat up in the water, on the pole and stuff like this. It accounted for some really big weights. But of course what they started to do with the meat, they started to put it through, cut it up and push it through riddles and stuff.
That's the maggot riddles, yeah?
Yeah, maggot riddles. They used to push the meat through that. And of course we used to ball it in or cut so much of it in that it created like oil slicks on the water.
From the fat
out of the meat. And of course Morelands, John Talbot at the time decided to ban it as a feed, but you could only use it on the hook a quarter of an inch then, those days. And the same with Mike Mason at Woodlands, he'd done the same thing. And of course it's all swings and roundabouts as you go, and it's all turntail these days. And we come to these sort of machines now, Whereas they cut, if you look at the blades we've got here now,
they come in a variety of sizes, do they?
They come like this. So this is the one we're using, a 6, or we'll use an 8mm cutter, but those are what we're using at the moment. They do go down to a 4mm in the smaller sizes.
Yeah.
We can get also, they're going up to now 7 and 8 and 10 mil.
Oh, bigger ones, yeah.
All up to 10 mil, yeah. So it goes from 4 to 10 mil these days.
And this entrance port here is obviously the same size as a regulation tin of meat from the supermarket or anywhere, tackle shop.
Oh, yeah, that's right.
Size.
But these machines, they're wonderful these days. When we started off, they were just a wooden machine. We put like pipe trace wire in them.
Oh really?
Yeah, and of course we only cut one size, as I say, those days. But now, with these machines, you can cut all sizes. The blades, they come out like this. Sharp end up to the cut, Absolutely brilliant tools.
But what are the squares there? Is that just a different set of cutters in there?
That's a different set of cutters.
So you've got two cutters in there if you want to use them, yeah?
Well,
and it comes out of this end, is it?
What we do, that is the single, I don't know if the camera can pick that up, that is the single cut, first cut.
Oh, I see.
And then we turn the machine to the side. We put this onto the side of there. We get our tub like this. And then we get, a tin of meat.
So can it not cut a square like this? It doesn't cut a square. It cuts one way and it cuts the other way.
Cuts the other, yeah.
I see.
So if we drop the meat in like this, it's quite simple. And we just follow that through. That's cut that direction. I hold it in here. There is a thing that a stop that goes onto here, but I don't use that just for speed. We sell so much of it, you know.
Really?
Yeah. And then we follow that over then into the tray like that. Push down again. Back up like that. And it is. There we go.
Give it a shake, guys. Did you see that in
and
there?
It's come to that. They'll all break up. You'll get a bit sticking together like that. But there. That's basically it.
And the thing is, you'd be ages doing that with a knife, and you never get them all uniform.
Oh, no,
I mean,
no,
that way you get a sort of like a particle presentation. The fish must just get so used to feeding on that one side, hopefully they just suck it in, you know, with no problem.
That's right, yes, because we're actually feeding this. You want to put on the hook what you're actually feeding them.
Gotcha.
That's where it gives you the results. Some people will use, say, a bigger piece, thinking they're going to get the bigger fish. It doesn't always work like that.
Now, Clive, what about when I used to do a lot of barbel fishing on the Avon? We used big Q, you know, real big, you know, inch and a half pieces on a big carp hook. But everybody said, get this, mate, get that, mate, because they have different fat contents in them. Is there any particular brand, you know, or meats, or are they all pretty much of a muchness nowadays?
Plumrose is the one that most people we find like the best, you know. That's the brand that we sell. We just stay with that because we've always found it the best, you know.
Yeah, yeah.
There are a few people that use the other cheaper meats as they do, but
it cuts nice, that it one. Comes you can off, see that. It does yeah, cut it nice, come, yeah.
It comes off the hook so easy, a lot of it, and a lot of it's got too much fat in it. You know, this is more meat-based. People just like this sort of meat, you know, they go for this. As I say, we sell quite a lot of it. So
that sort of history of that, has that come from match fishing up here in the Midlands? Is that where it's really come from? You know, or pleasure fishing?
I'd say where it came from in the first place was the river, the Severn.
From the river fishing, for the barbel?
Yeah. I've got you,
yeah.
You know, even some years ago when the river was bank high and muddy then, meat was the thing, you know.
Oh, really?
Yeah. Big meat lead and a big chunk of meat.
Now, can you, I mean, it's obviously, it smells of luncheon meat, it smells of barbel to me, but can you flavour it, colour it or anything?
Yeah, we can. Yeah, we use this Aramix.
Yeah.
That's Sensus. When we buy it in, it comes in like this. I don't know if the camera can pick that up. It comes in more of a like pinky colour to the meat.
Yes.
So what we do, we put a dye in it, and this is the one we use. We use this sort of dye, a mainline red dye, and to a bottle of this roughly, I'll split a bottle down into two.
Yeah.
And then probably a teaspoonful of that to one bottle would, you know, colour that up.
Now, I know you get through quite a lot of meat here, and I don't know that people realise just how much. Out of two angling centres, Mal's got another one in Howells Owen, both good angling centres, both first class for bait, but you get through a phenomenal amount of meat here. So, I mean, what sort of volume do you get through?
In the winter time, of course, it's quiet then.
Yeah.
But when you come to the summertime, I mean, it's Monday today. I left the shop on Friday, and the tins of meat, as you can see at the side of the counter here,
they were
probably this high.
So there's 10 packs there.
Yeah.
That's so 80, so at least 80 have gone out of one shop in one day.
In one day.
80 cans of meat in one day.
It just shows when it's fishing, that's how popular it is, when the meat's going, that's it, you know.
Listen, the anglers must be catching. On the meat, because that guy that came in earlier, he came in for meat.
Yeah, that's right.
You've done 80 cans of meat in one shop in one day.
Yeah.
It shows you the phenomenal popularity and success of that bait.
Yeah. Well, you can imagine how it must be fishing on the rivers as well. He's had one bag to go on to Moorlands, a fishery like that. So he knows it's working in the margins, but he only needs one bag for a match.
Yeah.
But if you go onto the river, you're probably going to need at least 4 or 5 tins, because it's not just throwing a lump of meat out as it used to be years ago.
Yes.
When there were, I'd say there were a lot more barbel in those days. These days it's more of a, especially with the rivers I say being as it is, you need to keep feeding a little bit, you know.
Little and often.
Little and often, as they say, when you're using this float method especially, and just trundling down with it, and that's the way of catching your weight.
So yeah, if we could see some colouring, you know, if you do some colouring,
no problem.
Oh, there's a gentleman there.
Oh, morning, eh? You all right, mate? How you doing?
If I come for some lunch meat, please.
Oh, yeah, yeah. All right,
there you go. There's a customer coming in for lunch and meat, and we're making it.
Four mil, please.
Four mil.
Yeah, please.
One bag, two bags?
No, just one bag, please.
So you're using 4 mil?
Yeah, four mil, yeah.
What sort of stuff are you going for?
Carp, mainly barbel.
Yeah.
Chub.
So it really is popular then, this meat? I mean, we got it, you know.
Yeah, it's good, yeah, especially at Moorlands.
Yeah?
Yeah.
You won't fish at a distance, are we? You're going to fish it in the margins?
In the margins, in about top two in front of me.
Yeah.
So.
Oh, well, you know what you're doing, yeah. Yeah.
Hopefully.
Now, what about this colour one? Clive's going to do some colouring. Do you ever try the colouring?
Yeah, the red dye colouring, yeah. Really good.
That's good. And flavouring as well?
Yeah, flavouring, yeah. Strawberry.
Just
using plain tomorrow.
Oh, well, good luck with it.
Hopefully.
Good job you just wanted one bag. We've got one in there.
Oh, yeah.
But I'm just cutting some now to dye up.
Oh, yeah.
Anyway, cheers, mate. Have a good day.
And you, mate. Take
See
care.
See you in a bit.
Good luck with it. Cheers, then.
Yeah, right, well, what I normally do, we've cut that up now, yeah, and I drop it into a bag, quite simple.
They don't think we faked that, you know.
we didn't. That worked out wonderful, didn't it?
Didn't it? Yeah, he actually did come in for lunch and meat.
Right, we got it like that. I just normally do just a quick splodge like that.
Don't need to dilute it or anything then, no?
No, that has actually...
Very, very strong concentrate, is it, that one?
You can if you want to make it... go a bit farther if you want,
yeah,
is to just water it down slightly.
Gotcha.
Because it is quite concentrated, but you'll see what I mean when I've done this. Just give it a quick shake like that, and you'll see that should be perfectly dyed.
Wow, that is red,
ready for the hook there. If you want to just get the camera on that. Absolutely perfect, look.
Now, does that soak up dry out, or are we all going home with red fingers?
That will soak up. We'll keep that in the fridge to keep it fresh, you know.
Yeah, how long can you keep those fridge, you know, if anglers want to have some left over?
Probably a week, but maybe a bit like you can freeze it. That's the beauty of
it. Oh, really?
Yeah.
Yeah.
If you make quite an amount of it that you don't want to waste, you just drop it in the freezer. Take it out on the morning you're going off, especially these warm mornings now, and it will thaw out in no time. Perfect. And I just tie the bag down like this.
Airtight there, so you spun it right up airtight as you can get it, yeah?
Yeah, and that's it. And that's basically it. That's the meat made for your commercials. A lot of people swear by that. We sell quite a lot of that as well. We did, what it was some years ago, when I started doing this, when we had the old wooden machine, as I say, it's come to this now, it was just plain meat. And we were buying in tins of strawberry meat, and I thought, well, why not have a little go at this? So we started to have a little go at it and messed about with the dyes and the flavours. And as I say, I told you which I found, this is the best one anyway.
Yeah.
And it seems everybody started to do it then, you know, after a bit.
They copy you like anything fishing, they're going to copy, aren't they?
Exactly, yeah. And but it really took off, you know. And these days, meat is so much more popular on the commercials now than it's ever been, you know.
Yeah, so it's only the fact of the ball in the ground baiting, the mush as it were, that sort of created the problem. And what was that, not eaten by the fish, or it didn't break down, the fat content, what was their argument against it? I mean, look, fisheries, as I always see them, they want you to catch fish, but they don't sort of want you to catch too many fish. And when anything gets really good in fishing, invariably, it gets banned. So what was the sort of thinking behind it? Was it the fat content?
Yeah, it was, basically, because if you can imagine a fishery at the time this happened, when it was banned as pushing it through the riddles and things like that, is that John Talbot, that owned Moorlands at the time, and Mike Mason at Woodlands, the two main fisheries at the time, they noticed, they went down to the lake one morning and it was covered in all different colours of the rainbow, and it was it was fat from the meat they found.
Yeah.
So of course they banned that, and it had to be at the time half inch cubes,
which is huge,
or larger, and you couldn't feed any. You know, you just put it on the hook. As I say, of course, these days it has changed, gone back.
You've gone backwards, haven't you, really? Yeah, you're just using small bits, it's gone full circle.
And now they're coming back to this, as I say, this formal stuff, which is basically...
It's small, isn't it? Yeah.
You could push that, slice it if you wanted to. You don't have to use a machine. You could slice it.
Yes.
And push it through a riddle.
Yeah.
That's one way.
I see what you mean. Cut this along here thin.
That's it. Just slide on it.
And then just physically push it through the
riddle. Slide on its side. Just slice it up to the diameter you want. And just push it through the
piece
riddle.
Piece of wood or something like that.
Over the top of here. Push it through the riddle. Job done.
That's it.
You could even colour that if you wanted to as well.
Yeah.
But with the thing is, they found that it was creating a lot of oil or grease, which takes the oxygen out of the water, of course.
Oh, I see.
So,
yes.
You know, deoxygenates it. So because of those problems, that's why they stopped that. But of course, these days, there are still a lot of fisheries that do not allow you to feed the meat.
Yes.
You know, so...
Mostly still waters, I imagine. Actually, the river's okay, I imagine, because it all disappears and it's gone anyway, is it?
Well, one of our friends, a local chap, he fishes the river a lot. You know, and it's accounted for some really big weights, as I say, in this warm weather, going back to the like loafer type floats.
Yeah.
And trundling the meat through, it's accounted for some really decent barbel and chub. A lot of big chub come out this year too. You know.
Oh really? Yeah.
Yeah, quite big chub. He said in a session that he probably had around 80 to 100 pounds.
Oh, big weights and big weights.
In about 3-4 hours, yeah, really good. You know.
Good lord.
Yeah. But I think you're going up there yourself, are you not?
Well, I mean, if anybody doesn't know, Mel Storey was one of the top matchmen in the area, wasn't he, with the barbel? Now, I know his name from 30 years ago when I used to I came up here and did a story on him. And it was just silly fishing next to him because I think I caught one barbel and I'd done about 3 keep nets, I should think he filled. So I need to talk to Mel. It's his shop. We're going to go, upstairs in the office?
Yeah.
And he's going to give us an idea where we're going to go, because we don't really know what we're fishing for. We came to do a film about the luncheon meat, and you know, we were thinking of doing a carp stillwater, but I think we're going for my favourite species. And I don't know if it's swim feeder or what. Let's go and see Mel. Clive?
Tight lines, mate.
Thank you very much indeed for the information. I hope YouTube viewers there, guys, you've seen these cutting blades for your meat. And listen, you can lot of different species as well. I mean, it's not just barbel and carp. I think there's a lot of other species will eat these small diameter ones.
Yeah.
And you've got the option of, you know, colouring, flavouring, or you come into one of Mal's two shops and you've got it all ready made. It's all done for you, and you know it's done properly, and you know you've got the right mix of colouring and flavouring. Clive, thank you very much.
Okay, cheers, buddy.
Well, I'm afraid Clive has done my head in down there with all that lunch and meat talk. And as I said, Mal is the man to talk about. Barbel Mal, good to see you, mate.
Good to see you, Graham.
Good to be up here again. Now then, what young Clive was telling me down there, and obviously I'm totally zoned in now because I used to light years ago on Hampshire Avon float fishing for barbel with big cubes of lunch on me. But you now tell me that you can catch, you know, barbel and chub and other stuff on the float on these small bits of lunch on me.
Well,
tell us about it.
That's true. You can catch on the small bits, but you also catch on the larger pieces as well. What you can feed the theory is feed the small one, fish with a bigger one on the hook.
So size wise, you'd be going at what millimeter on luncheon meat for feed and hook bait?
I think 4 mil to feed, probably 6-8 on the hook. And of course, you don't have to put a cube on. You can break a piece off.
Oh, I see.
Off a tin, you open a tin of meat and break a piece off, and you can hook that on as well, and the bits flake off it. You know, that's sometimes a bit of a temptation for the fish.
Now, but you don't use any ground bait or anything. This is just straight meat.
Straight meat.
Particles of meat.
Just catapult some small cubes in down the centre of the river and run a big specy waggler through, over the top of them or through them, and you catch barbel and chub, you know, perfectly.
Well, now. Years ago, when I was float fishing, it was all Body Dave and floats, holding back hard, you know, overshotting, shotting near the bottom.
Yes.
You've mentioned the word waggler, and you know, those guys that know, waggler to me is bottom end only, still water fishing. But apart from a slow river, where I would let it run through. But how does that work? Because it's, you know, it's a Severn's a fast river.
It is a fast river. Yeah, I mean, you can still use a heavy balsa sort of float or crystal float and hold it back if you want to. But the successful thing to do these days is to use a special waddler. If you use an ordinary sort of standard thin waddler that you'd use
still waters,
you know, and even on the river, but the problem you've got on the shallow water where you're going to catch fish now, it'll keep pulling under. Especially yeah. waggler is thick, and therefore it rides the current well, and it don't keep pulling under, and therefore that's the successful method of catching marbl and chub on the Severn at the moment.
And the shotting pattern with a waggler generally is bulk shotting underneath the the bottom end of the float. The guys know the waggler's here, and the bulk of the shots in. You might have one down here, dust or something like that. So, what's the shotting pattern with those floats you use?
Sometimes they put some shot down the line. Where we're going later on to fish, you'll see that the guy that's doing it, Richard, he puts his bulk underneath the float, and he'll be fishing what sort of 3 to 5 feet deep with no shot down the line at all. So in effect, it's running through the river, and it's lifting, it's up and down, and it's just a very successful way of catching fish.
And what size would the barbel be running there? Are they sort of 2, 3, 4 pounders would be an average fish? Or?
I think a little bit bigger than 2 and 3. I think you'd probably be talking 4 to 8.
Oh, really good fish, then.
And the chub also, you know, 3 pounds plus, which is, you know, 3 pound chub's a nice fish, but some of the ones coming out at the moment, since the season started, you know, they've been getting them 5 and 6 pound, which is a massive fish for the chub. It's really nice to see.
That's good. Mm. Any other stuff there? Dace, roach, perch, that sort of?
If you want to, I mean, we've started off brilliantly this season. It's probably the best start to a season on the River Severn for some time. If you wanted to go and catch silverfish, then you take maggots or casters, run a waggler through again, which is probably the best, you know, you catch on the stick, but waggler's the best at the moment, the best method at the moment.
Yeah.
And you'll catch, I mean, some of the weights on the matches, people have been getting sort of low 20 pounds of dace, and there's quite a lot of big perch showing up and chub, you know, so there's plenty of fish to be caught on the float other than barbel and chub.
Now, this last winter, we're talking 2014, we're here up at Mount Stories Fishing Centre. The fact you said that the river's fishing really, you know, well at the moment, do you think that's attributable to a good clean out, a good scouring by all those big winter floods we had? Could that be the reason it's fishing well?
That is a possibility, but I have to say that prior to the season starting, the week before, we had a lot of heavy rain, torrential stuff, and the river lifted up. And we're all thinking, is it going to be of a decent level for the start of the season? Yes, it did run down, but it left us with an inch or two on and a tinge of colouring. And that those first sort of 3 weeks of the season, it seemed, you know, it didn't matter where you went fishing. I mean, Stourport's a good place to go fishing, but it's renowned for its winter fishing for roach. Well, anglers are going down to Stourport and they're catching them 2 pound a time roach.
Yeah, big fish.
Big fish. Lovely fish roach of 2 pound. So, therefore, that tinge of colour and that little bit of extra water has done the trick. Having said that, the last week or so, it's just sort of started to tail off a little bit as the river's come to normal and the colour's gone out of it, you know.
Yeah.
So it's a little bit harder. Same old problem, middle of the day, sunshine from sort of 10, 11 o'clock onwards till about 4. For some unknown reason, well, we know the reason, it's sort of, especially on the middle Severn, the shallower, clearer water, the fish can, it sort of magnifies the line, it magnifies the hook size, and they, you know, you struggle to catch them unless you find down. But, you know, up until, so if you go early in the morning up to about 9, 10 o'clock, and then 4 o'clock till it gets dark, that's the time to go, yeah, and that's when you'll catch them.
Well, appreciate it. It sounds like you're going to come down and have a little session with us with a bit of lager.
We will. We'll come up and have a ride up to Bridge North a bit later on this afternoon, and hopefully we can show you the two methods, perhaps, because what we haven't pointed out is that since the season started, where pellets been the thing in the past,
pellet,
and halibut pellets, that is, this time it seems to have turned the corner a bit. It's gone back to casters and hemp and maggots, particularly casters and hemp. Dave Williams, guy I know well, used to fish in the same team as myself. He's won the first two Kidderminster Opens, £69, £59, and he always uses casters and hemp.
Really?
And so that's come to the fore a bit this time, I've noticed, and the pellets seem to be fading away a little bit. So be interested to see if we can catch any on Castle's Hemp up there and also on this float fish luncheon meat.
Well, fingers crossed, yeah. I should be using the float, and I guess you're going to be on the feeder.
I think you could well be right.
down on the river now, and we're going to be talking with Richard, who actually lives in Bridgnorth, been fishing the river many, many years, and he's going to give us some of those tips for float fishing, because, you know, to me, it's really pretty fast here, and we'll get a bit more information and insight for you guys on this technique.
Basically, all I'm using is a 6-pound line, straight through, size 10 hook, a specimen waggler, hooked up around the float, so the meat will just drop nicely through the water and look as natural as possible. And that's it, a simple rig.
Do you have any, like a dust shot halfway down to take it down? Or it literally is almost like freelining?
Freelining, that's all I use.
And it doesn't matter which size, you know, millimetre of luncheon meat you're using?
No, bigger the better.
Really?
Chub have got big mouths.
Now, are you bumping the bait along the bottom? Is that the sort of technique?
Yeah, just bumping the bait along the bottom.
So do you, with a waggler, you can't sort of hold it back, can you? Like a top end only. So you've got to let it go through. The minute it goes under, do you strike and sort of risk it? Oh, well, it might be a rock or something, but it could be a fish.
Usually if it's a chub or a barbel, they'll just take it straight down.
Okay.
There's no messing about.
No finesse with it?
No, it's just as it is, really.
So if anybody's starting this technique, and it's new to me as well, you're over depth from what's in front of you there, you say, yeah, 4 foot?
Yeah, 4 foot, and it's probably about 3.5 foot. So I'm like half a foot over depth.
That's it, good.
And just bouncing it along the bottom.
Now, early on, you mentioned to me one of the good catches you had here quite recently. What was that catch you had then?
Had 13 chub and about 8 barbel.
That's phenomenal, yeah.
Just using the same.
Same setup. Well, let's crack on. And Mal's down there. We're going to have a word with Mal, see if he's going to pull one out on the feeder for us. It'd be a shame if he can't. He should be. He's the feeder man.
Yeah.
And fingers crossed, I'm going to float fish and Mike's going to be up there. He's going to go on the feeder. So we've got 2 on float, 2 on feeder.
Good.
One on the float knows what he's doing, and possibly he's not me. So we're banking on you. Okay, there we go, nice chub. Unfortunately, we're trying for barbel, but so far I've been pestered with lots of little dace, and that's the first sort of decent fish we've had, but it's a chub, but it's better than nothing.
Good bite, Mel. What type of bite?
Lovely lift, flew back, a nice lift back
bite. Like a slack liner, what we call in cod fishing, it comes back?
Top of the rod, shot back, yeah.
Oh, really?
Yeah.
You strike straight away then?
Straight away, yeah. Took up got a little bit of a bow in the line, so I just took up the slack line. And it
so if kids see that, if they get a slack line in their quiver tip, just strike
back.
Anyway,
yes.
It flies back, it's a good
that's
tip.
That's right, yeah, that's it.
Oh, nice fish, yeah.
Okay, we'll put him back. There we go. Look at that, he's spewed up.
Oh,
You see what he spewed up there?
He spewed up luncheon meat.
He spewed my luncheon meat that I feed it up there.
Or Richard's in the next peg up. That's what he's feeding on. But
he's eating the luncheon meat there. The guys can just see that on the bed.
Yeah.
Gravel bed there.
Well, here's another tip when we're using a bow in the line to hold the feeder out in the fast flow. Quite often, if you take the line by your butt ring and pull it back to the reel and let it go, that causes the feeder to roll downstream, not pull towards you, cause it to roll downstream, natural movement. So the hook length is moving downstream with it, and that quite often instigates a bite.
Because you're not pulling out of position then, I suppose, then,
no,
are you
no,
really?
You keep it in the
same line.
If you've got a tight line and pull it,
you're pulling the feeder out.
Which is not natural to a fish.
Oh, that's a good tip, yeah.
It wasn't long before Richard was soon some yet more fish. I'm not going to say he was catching one after the other, but he was making all our total catches between us look ridiculous. Not as ridiculous as all these geese floating downstream, and I've never seen geese on a river like that before. But he was working away, and Mike was on the swim feeder at the top end of the swim, while Mal was on a swim feeder at the bottom end of the swim, and in the middle Richard was working away there, running down that luncheon meat underneath that specy waggler float, and in the current it definitely, I did notice, held well. he was soon into another chub. He'd been started there before us. He knew exactly where to go, and he does a lot of this fishing. So hardly surprising, he's gonna start cranking on fish one after the other. And there you can see the waggler swinging in the top as he draws a pretty good chub towards the net. So this method was new to me, but it certainly appears to be very efficient. Is that the sort of average size you get in here, Richard?
You're getting bigger than this. 4 pound.
Yeah.
So it's just...
Sort of, and that's on that big piece of meat you showed us, those big cubes you got down there.
Yeah.
Another thing I noticed was that while I was using very small cubes that were pre-cut in the Kidderminster Tackle Shop, the big fish were coming out on the big baits, the big cubes of luncheon meat. So always get a few, maybe a couple of cans cut open and leave them as large pieces, you know, in your tackle bait box or your, you know, carrier bag, anything you're going to keep them and keep the air from it, and it'll last a long time. Because if you're feeding small pieces, what I found was that I had to double up, put two or three of the small sort of 4mm sizes on to make a decent bait. And occasionally in the current, they just sort of wash apart. They just didn't look right. It didn't look right. But, you know, with the rod bent like this, you can understand why I was looking, thinking, oh, big pieces obviously do get the fish here. So it might pay you. As Mal said earlier on, you feed the small particles and then you run down your float, you know, with your bait, with a much bigger size, maybe even using a sort of size 10 or even a size 6 hook on it. They're not shy, and don't forget, they're feeding in this river. It's quite fast flowing. As soon as something goes past their face, they really haven't got much time to make a decision on whether, you know, shall I take it, shall I not take it? Because if it goes past their head, the chub behind the barb or behind the roach to perch, whatever's behind them, is gonna nail it, so they can't really turn around. So keep that feed going in little and often, and then you get the fun of watching this float run down. You can actually see this bite here now. Mike changed over to try some casters at the top end of the swim. Went off with the luncheon meat. In retrospect now, I think if he'd have kept a big hook and kept the hemper caster in the feeder but a big piece of luncheon meat, he could have got some more fish.
Here we go, guys, it's my 750,000th cast and trot down. Big piece of luncheon meat, big piece, because I noticed Richard was using big bits. I lost the fish earlier on, and it's a really, really nice chub, this one. I just hope that we get our gilly here, Richard, and get this one netted. Don't lose him for us, Richard.
That's a nice chub.
It's a nice chub. He's a nice chub. He's going for the camera. Oh, what a cracker.
That's a really nice chub.
Get in all the hook work as well. That's a buster. Look at that one. What a beauty. What a beauty.
That's
he's
a good fish.
Getting up towards four, isn't he, Richard? That's a hell of a fish. Yeah. Do you know what we've been up there? We took Mal back. It took four of us to get him back up there to the van.
You took pretty long.
No, we're having a chat.
You have to carry him.
And this is Mal's swim and first trot down. It's between, well, I suppose it's where you've been baiting up in it really, Richard. First trot down, the float just submerged. It just went. And there we go, let's take a look at it. Let's get this wonderful hook out. If I get it out, it's the most weird shaped hook I just happened to find. Don't know if anybody can see that. What? That shaped hook, it's got a... It's a special one. I don't know what it's for, actually. Some of you guys might know if you can see the shape in that. I've no idea. It's a special hook. I don't know if it's for hair rigging or something like that.
It's offset, isn't it?
It's a weird offset on it, isn't it?
I think it's a carp hook.
Don't know. It's a chub hook now. It's a chub hook. I'll give Rich, if you just grab that one sec. I'll show the folks this lunker of a chub. And then we'll let him go. And then we're going to see the contents of Richard's keep net. Look at that, ladies. That's not bad, is it? And that I still consider to be lucky. I just said, should have a trot down where Mal was fishing. That was a wise move. There we go. Lovely fish on the River Severn. Back it goes. And that's probably going to swim straight away. Big belly on it too. Let me recover a minute. Gone. Well, I'm okay, but now I'm going to get a bit of indigestion because I'm going to have to look at the contents of his keep now. It's not going to be a pretty sight. Well, people, we're going to see what Richard's got in his net. And this is what you get. I still can't believe it. On a free stretch, Mike.
A free stretch, yeah.
A free stretch of river looking with a setting like this. I mean, it's pretty amazing. Now let's check out what he's got in the net. Oh, that's a good catch there, isn't it? I can see those through this side. Look at them. Chub, big chub, barbel in there.
Yeah.
Well, I'll let you release those, Richard. See, you've got a...
The fish want to go.
If you put them by that brick when you release them.
Yeah.
Lovely looking fish. And this is probably the best way for fish, you know, rather than have on the bank, you can release it straight into the water. Oh, nice chub. Gone. They're all fresh, aren't they?
Yeah.
There's the chap we want to see. Here we go, guys. On the float.
It's a little chub.
That's the ultimate fishing, is a barbel on the float. And what size barbel can you get here, Richard, you know, on this stretch?
10, 15.
Oh, big ones. 10 or 15 pounds.
Yeah.
Christ, one of those on the float would be something, wouldn't it?
Yes, it would be.
I knew he'd do that. And what would you say your biggest bag is here, you know, weight wise? Have you any big match weights or anything? Or
probably about 80.
About 80 pounds?
Yeah.
Really? Oh God, brilliant. Well, that's not bad for what, an afternoon's fishing?
That's it.
And half the time you've been messing about with us and helping people up cliffs. That's brilliant. Well, it gives everybody a good idea of what sort of fishing you can have up this way on the river service. I appreciate
your
help.
And it's a free stretch.
A free? It's unbelievable, isn't it, mate? No, it's kicking, isn't it?
It's kicking, yeah.
Right, just keep pressure on it, walk down. Don't fall over. Well, people, we're following Mike down. We're just on our way to Bewdley, Richard. With this fish. We've done about 300 yards already.
Just there's the float, I can't see the fish.
No, it was kicking, it's definitely kicking. He's out. Keep the pressure on him, keep coming down. That's it, keep walking with him, keep the pressure on him. And watch this island. That's it, now so I play him about there. And put your rod to the right.
To the right?
Yeah. I'll see if we can get him on the float. He's too much on the surface for barbel, isn't he? I don't think Michael's worried, are you, Mike?
What?
He said he's probably too much on the surface to be a...
That's a chub?
Oh, it's a chub, that'll do. Your first chub on the float for you. Just watch that and twist round.
Probably my biggest chub, to be honest.
It might be, absolutely. Yeah, it's the first one on the float, I think, you've had.
A pound and a half. Sort of
yeah, it doesn't matter, yeah. He must have gotten the weed over there, hadn't he? Just dug in the weed.
Yeah, it was locked off, didn't it?
Triple
find any snag, and I'll just go straight for it. So that was a bit of an instant change, wasn't it, Mike? Same thing, first trot down, wasn't it, or second trot down?
Second, yeah.
Get it! Save the blank again! Save the blank! Nice chub too, nice chub.
Yeah. Probably a PB for me.
That's a PB chub for you, definitely.
A PB.
Yeah, that's
a PB. I don't know how big it'd be, but... Bigger than the ones I've caught before.
He's
I must have been eight the last time I caught a chub.
Yeah, no, look at that. And that lucky hook still in his jaw, I can see it.
Look at the size of his mouth.
Yeah,
huge,
so you have no trouble taking those big bits of lunch of meat, will he? Well done.
Straight on the meat, yeah. I've first technique as well. I've never used that technique.
Yeah, that's good.
Cheers.
Do you want to...
Here we go. It's ready to be released. We've got some stills. And there is probably my PB chub. Oh, on the River Severn, it's gone.
And there it is.
That was bound to happen. But yeah, thanks to Richard's tips, trotting that meat down, that was good fun. Enjoyed that. We'll get probably another 15 minutes worth.
Oh, really? Oh, then, all changed now, isn't it? All changed, yeah. Okay. I won't get the float rod back now, will I?
Yeah. No. second chop down,
and it looks like possibly another PB chub. We reckon just over 3. Put up a good scrap. Nice looking fish. Back in the water, and we'll go see if we can get one on the third trot. Sorry, Dad, I'm not giving you your rod back now.
I realise that. I realise I'm done now.
Away. Awesome.